So we have the pattern here, and we've come all the way down to the point where we'll attach the side pullouts for pulling out the tarp on either side when it's set to give you a little bit more space inside the tarp. And the instructions say that the side panel pulls should be 6 inches long and 3 inches wide. And the instructions here have attaching the webbing to the outside of the panel pull. So just like I've done the other parts where I've embedded the webbing inside the nylon fabric, I'm going to also do that with these side pullouts. I'm going to cut some small strips of the nylon, and I'm going to sew a seam right down the center of the pull to allow the D-ring to come out. I have some of these D-rings that I'm going to put right inside there, just like the image, but instead of sewing them to the outside, I'm going to put the ends of the webbing on the inside of the fabric. So I'll show you how I do that next. I'm cutting the fabric so that it's 4 inches wide. That'll give me a 1/2 inch seam allowance on both sides. I'm not going to use my rolled hem foot on these side pullouts to finish the edge like I did on the edge of my tarp. And the reason I'm not going to use it here is because I want to also sew the pullouts to the tarp in an area where I've got it folded over. I'll show you that. But I don't want to have it so that I can't, you know, hit two layers of this nylon. I want to sew through when I've got it on the double layer. I am really at a point where I have got to change my rotary cutter. Remind me to do that if I don't do it. In order to get the 6 inch length on this, and if I roll the ends down, I'll have a 1/2 inch seam allowance on each side, and then I'll have another 1/2 inch seam allowance where I attach it together. So I need to actually add 2 inches of seam allowance to these. So I'm going to cut each piece so that they'll be 8 inches long. So I'm going to want a running piece here that is going to be 32 inches long. So I'm just going to do the whole strip here. I'm using my pins, and I'm using the board here as a guide to fold the hem instead of my rolled hem foot. And the reason for that is when I attach this to the tarp, I want a nice wide area where I have two layers of this fabric. If I use the rolled hem foot, I'm only going to have about 1/8 of an inch where I've got it rolled over, and in addition to that, it's going to be a triple hem. So I'm doing my pins kind of far apart. I would say these are about 9 or 8 inches apart. And the reason for that is when I set these straight lines right in the machine and I have the needle in and the foot down, I can just come back from to one point where the pin is and fold that in, and it'll be taut. So I'm going to pin one side, sew it, and then I'll pin the other side. That way I don't have these conflicting curls messing things up. So we'll do that on the machine. I'm going to change my foot back to my regular foot, and the foot I've been using is this one, which is nylon. If you don't have a foot like that, I mean, it's okay to use a standard foot, like the, you know, the metal ones. I just like this nylon foot when I'm using these slippery fabrics. I feel like it makes a little bit of a difference to have the slippery foot there, and that these fabrics are able to really slide across it. And I'm going to do this stitch kind of far in, because when I sew this actually to the tarp, I'll want to sew pretty close to the edge. That'll make it easier for seam sealing. But this stitch I'm going to do kind of far in and grab that fabric. And I'm not going to bother to block my stitches here because I'm going to be cutting this fabric all the way across through stitches repeatedly on this. So, you know, that doesn't really matter. And I've got my fabric lined up. I use these guides here on the side of the plate. You can see I'm using the 10 millimeter, and I have my needle pretty far over to the left. I've got my needle in the one position to give me a nice wide area there. You see what I've got going on here? I've got some thread from the end of the fabric. It's wound its way up in there and just kind of pulls along. That's annoying. It doesn't really harm anything. I can just trim it away, but it's annoying. Okay, we're stopping with our needle in the down position and we're removing our pins. I've gotten some questions from folks about how I get my needle to stop in the down position. There's a button right off frame here on my Husqvarna Viking Emerald 118. And if I press that, it'll push the needle down. And then every time I take my foot off the pedal, I get it in the same position as where I pressed it. So if I want my foot every time I stop the machine to be in the down position, I just depress that. And if I change my mind and I want it to be up, I just press it again. It's a really neat feature on the machine, and I like that it has it. Not all machines have it. My Singer that I had for years, that I kind of destroyed before I got this machine, I will call it years of sewing difficult things and heavy abuse projects. But it was just a, you know, it was a kid's entry-level machine. I got it when I was in sixth grade, so that I was actually able to use it for about 30 years, I think is pretty good. But when I retired that machine and I got a new one, and I talked to the people in the sewing machine store, oh, I saw that down needle position, and I said, that is just great. That's exactly what I want. So here you can see that piece that was hanging up on me that caused it to fold over in the back. So I just am going to pull that and take it away. Then I'll pin this side and then we'll sew this side up. The seams on my long pieces of nylon are sewn, and I have these basic D-rings here, which I'm going to attach, and I'm going to use just some of the same basic webbing I've been using in the rest of the project. So these are now 3 inches wide, and I need them to be at a finished length 6 inches long. So I'm going to cut 2 pieces each that are 4 inches in length so that I can sew the webbing on the inside and then have all of the webbing buried except the part that's attached to the D-ring. So I'm just going to use my straight tool here. And cut 4-inch pieces. I'm using my rotary cutter and a straight edge. And I'm just going right through the seam because I'm going to be sewing these edges, so that's going to actually lock the stitch. You won't have to worry about locking the stitches if you are going to sew across them. So we'll be fine with those stitches. So I have the base of my D-ring. If I put my little ruler here, right at the base of the D-ring where it's not going to bump anything, I have it 3/4 of an inch from the end. And that way when I sew with my sewing machine, my foot is not going to hit this. I don't have to worry about bumping the D-ring and then having my line become jagged or move over. It'll just be a nice smooth line. And I have my pins all facing out so that I can easily pull them out when I'm sewing. So I'm going to run a straight stitch at a half inch seam allowance here. And then on each of these sides, I'm going to do a half inch seam allowance. I like to have my pins always facing out from my sewing so that when I am working on my project and it's time to remove pins, I can easily just pull the pins out. If you put your pins straight along, there's sometimes when that's what you have to do, but when you put your pins straight along, it tends to make them much harder to remove. All right, so I have a guide here on my machine with various widths, and these are accurate if my needle is in the center position. And if I have it at a half inch seam allowance, my foot should just fit perfectly in there. So I'll just sew a straight seam, and I'm going to, on either side, lock the stitch, but I'm also going to lock the stitch again right where the other cross seam happens. That way I make sure I get a good lock to that. So I've got my stitch that I just cross sewing, and I remove my pins. I'll just back stitch right over where the cross stitching happened that I cut, and I will also back stitch at the end. And now I have my nice straight seam, and when I open it out, it'll look like this. And then I think that 7 inches was pretty good length. It comes almost down to the end, so I have enough room here. And if I should ever have a failure to my D-ring, for example, if this were to break and I had to remove it, I could put a mini carabiner or a split ring or something in this loop. I'd have enough space to attach something else. I'll just do the seams down both sides now, and just like I did on the other one, I'm going to lock, but I'm also going to lock right over where my cross stitching happened. Doesn't need to be a lot of lock stitching because these stitches are holding the flaps under, but they are not supporting the weight of the tarp. So they don't have to be, you know, ultra reinforced, because we are going to make another set of stitches all the way around where we are going to do that ultra reinforcing. And I'm getting lots and lots of stray threads here, so I want to make an effort to just trim all of those. I also want to make an effort where I have the corner here that's going to be lined up well, so I'm just going to hold that in place until the very last second so that I don't get those corners overlapping. So here's the first of four attachment points. It should be 6 inches by 3 inches, just like the instructions, and we'll be able to sew those on. Now I'm going to spread this out so that this webbing is all lined up beautifully. I open it out, and I'm going to run a seam through it and do some reinforcement X's. And I want my X's to be pretty even, so I'm going to mark them with a pencil. So if I run my seams right where I'm marking, then I know my stitches will be straight and beautiful, and I won't have problems with weird shaped X's or anything. Probably doesn't matter to a lot of people, but I think it would bother me. So I'm going to just line everything up to hold this straight and keep it from torquing. I'm going to put a pin in this end and then drop my needle down. I'm going to lock my stitch a couple of times because this is now reinforcement stuff. This is going to get a lot of strain. So we definitely want to make sure we give it a nice solid reinforcement. Okay, now my needle is pointing in this direction and I'm going to sew to this mark. Now I'm going to sew straight across to this mark. I'm going to sew down to this mark here. And I'll sew across to this mark. Now I'm going to sew up, so I'll be coming back to this mark. Across this line again. We've already sewn this line, but we're going to have to get to this point, so we're going to sew across again. And now we'll sew back up to our original starting point. And we'll lock our stitches back and forth a couple of times. They'll need the extra reinforcement. I'm just going to trim my threads back on all the sides. Okay, we have the one side done. Now we'll do the exact same thing to the other side. Yes, you're a love and you're soaking wet. Have you been playing in the snow? Here, I'm going to show you guys this dog. Have you enjoyed the snow, Stuart, huh? He's such a good boy. Yeah, he loves to play in the snow. And look at that curly little tail. Look at that little, little curly tail. Yeah. Oh, here comes another dog. But this one doesn't like the camera. All right. Treasure canines. He wants to go out and play in the snow. Ive, do you want to go out and play in the snow? Yep. There they go. When your dogs get the in and outs, which is what I like to call it, where they want to go in and they want to come out, and they want to go in and they want to come out. It's just like up and down. They love these snowy days. Even though that little brindle dog of mine doesn't have much body fat at all and she doesn't have much fur, she gets hot. She does not want to wear a coat. I made her a coat and she won't wear it. She gets too hot and tries to pull it off. Although if it's ultra, ultra cold, then she'll wear it for a walk, but then as soon as she gets back in the house, she wants to take it off. Lock it a couple of times and then out we go. have all four of our tie-outs done. They're all 3 inches by 6 inches. They all have these little D-rings. They all look nice and pretty consistently sewn. So next what we'll do is we will place these on the tarp so that we'll have them lined up perfectly level, and we'll attach them to the tarp. And once we attach these to the tarp, we're pretty much done sewing on the tarp project. This is how DIY Gear Supply recommends putting the attachment points for the panel pullouts onto the tarp. They are 25 inches down from the ridge line and then 39 inches back from this point on the ridge line. That is the location where they've got this corner to the pullout. So we're going to put pins in place on each of our panel pullouts so that we have our panel pullouts properly placed. I've cleared my table off so that I can spread the tarp out, and I have my trusty jugs of milk here that I use to weigh this down, because this is really going to slide everywhere. So grab something heavy, even a rock will do. I have up here the seam of my ridge line, and I want to measure from the apex point. Move my milk so that I can actually put the measuring tape here. I want to measure down 39 inches. Okay, that's 39. I'm just going to put a pencil mark there. And I'm also, to save myself the aggravation, I'm going to put a pencil mark on the other side. Okay, I've got this now marked. So I've got the length down, and then I have the length here, and this is where I want my upper corner. And I'm going to want my upper corner on this side, and each one is going to be 39 inches down from that apex, and then 25 inches down in this direction. So I've marked this with a pencil, and now I'm just going to shift it up. Before I do shift it up, though, I'm going to run another line 6 inches down from that one. So that I make sure that I do have this. All right, there's 6 inches down. Make sure I do have this straight, because it would be a real shame to get this tarp all done and then put our pullouts on there crooked. Okay, so these are the two marks that I have for my pullouts. I'm just going to pull this up. That should be nice and level, and I see that it is level with the grain of the fabric. I have my trusty magazine that I'm going to slide in. It goes right underneath. That way we're not pinning through multiple layers of fabric. And we're just going to line the corners up and put our pins in. When I hit the magazine underneath, I pull it up. And then on this way. So here I have my piece pinned in. I have pins in the corners in each pin, and it takes 2 bites out of the fabric. And I have my pins going in multiple directions, and that'll just prevent the attachment point from sliding around and sliding off or getting to a place where it's in the wrong direction. And I'll remove my magazine and we'll keep pinning the other parts. So I'm feeding the fabric through under the foot here for the tarp. And I'm going to set my foot down, and I'm going to make sure before I put my needle down that I don't have any fabric looped under there, because that would be bad. You don't want to sew multiple layers of your tarp together. That's not the plan. So I'm just going to do a straight border all the way around all four edges. Just locking my stitch here. And I'm just going to go slowly. If I get to pins, I'm just removing pins. That I want to keep my needle down. I'm going to lift my foot and I'll swing the fabric around. And I'm going to also double check to make sure I don't have multiple layers tucked behind there. That would not be good. Keep your stitches slow and steady and close to the edge. I'm lifting my foot, but I'm not lifting my needle. Double checking to make sure that I don't have multiple layers of fabric looped under here. As I get close to pins, I'm just removing pins. Close to the end, I'll just lift the foot and swing the project around. When you get a lot of fabric inside the arm of your machine, you are in a very likelihood of having fabric tucked underneath that foot. So just take an extra moment and make sure that it's just one layer under here and not multiple layers. Okay, get back to the point where I started, and now I've completed the border. So I'm now going to do some reinforcement X's. I'm going to poke more fabric through. I'm going to spin this around one more time. I've got one layer in here, no more than that. Okay, my target for the needle will be this part right here. I'm just going to sew a straight seam there. Head straight for that target. When I get there, I will leave the needle in and lift the foot. And then we'll swing it around this way. And now my target will be this bottom corner. But again, before I sew, I want to make sure that's one layer and I have multiple layers. And I'm just sewing straight. And then I don't want to sew directly on top of the seam that I just sewed. So in this case, I've got a little space on the outside. I'm just going to go on the outside of it. Now I'm at the corner. I'm lifting the foot again. I'm swinging around. We are now in the position where maybe we could easily have more fabric looping under by accident. So let's just put our hand underneath here and make sure that that is not the case and that it is just one layer. Okay, now my target is this part right here. So I'm just going to sew straight to there. Now, pick up my foot and leave my needle in, and I'm going to head back to this far corner. And then before I start sewing, my hands coming underneath, I'm feeling everything feels nice. So here we have it. I'll just do a few reinforcement stitches at the end and turn the tails off. So here's what we've got. We have our attachment rectangle, 6 inches by 3 inches. We have our webbing sort of embedded inside that fabric. The webbing is attached with 2 X's on each side of reinforcement stitching, and then the entire piece is attached to the tarp with a border that goes all the way around the edges, and then a big X here and a big X there. This is what it looks like from the front, and then from the back we've got our bobbin thread in the same color as our tarp, so that it's less visible. Got the border stitching there, and then 2 X's. So the stitching parts of the tarp, that's now done.